Have you ever wondered what's happening inside your moss? Or how about a puddle? If you're lucky, tardigrades. Tardigrades might be in your moss. They're microscopic animals that are typically about 0.5 millimeter long and are pretty cute, but also absolutely sick. Because they have a superpower that allows them to survive the seemingly unsurvivable, and it's called cryptobiosis. And that is what we're getting into today. Oh my god, okay. I have so much to say. Because I was someone who went into my zoology major with a subpar understanding of animals. I didn't know sponges were animals, or insects, and don't even get me started on coral. So learning about something like cryptobiosis in a university classroom was like, what planet am I on right now? All right, let's get a general understanding of cryptobiosis out of the way. And don't worry, I have a lot to say about tardigrades, but quick facts first. So, the term cryptobiosis is defined as the state of an organism when it shows no visible signs of life in response to unfavorable environmental conditions. All metabolic activity stops. They don't reproduce, they don't grow, they don't repair anything. Essentially, if what's happening around them is physiologically unpleasant, they drop a step away from dead and can stay this way for a long time until the environment becomes more favorable again. Let's put it this way. Cryptobiosis is kind of like putting your life on pause. Could you imagine if humans could do this? Dude, we'd be so dramatic about it. LA transplants would go into cryptobiosis if their matcha tea was made with soy milk instead of oat. But the reality is, cryptobiosis allows organisms to survive events that we would immediately die in. Immediately. And there's a few different forms of cryptobiosis that can occur. There's osmobiosis, in response to increased solute concentration. Too much salt. Chemobiosis, in response to toxins. Too much chemicals. Cryobiosis, in response to decreased temperatures. Too much cold. Anoxibiosis, in response to little to no oxygen. Too much no oxygen. And the one we're most familiar with and have studied the most is anhydrobiosis, aka desiccation, aka drying out, in response to their habitat drying up. Too much dry. Think about the little tardigrades in the moss or the puddle that might sit in the sun for too long. This is where anhydrobiosis comes in handy. Now you might be thinking, Lindsay, you just made shit way too complicated. Too many terms. Don't worry, I'm not gonna use them ever again. Because I don't want to deal with that either. From this point on, I will use the umbrella term cryptobiosis, but just know there's different forms of it for different situations. Okay, so what kind of organisms do cryptobiosis? Tardigrades, of course, nematodes, rotifers, brine shrimp, even one insect called the sleeping chironomid, but also most plant seeds, which are packed with nutrients and extremely resilient to environmental stressors, and is one of the reasons why birds and small mammals were able to survive the KPG mass extinction, the dinosaur killing asteroid. They were able to dig up seeds and eat them. Also, microorganisms like yeast and bacterial spores and amoebas, but we're gonna focus on the animals. All right, let's get into the tardigrades. A lot of the following footage Gian will be putting here was shot by my friend Chloe, aka Tardibabe, on TikTok, Instagram, and YouTube. She's a microbio student from Montreal that gets phenomenal footage of their microverse, the microscopic world. She has these neon clips of nematodes and tardigrades and rotifers and more. It's so sick. I've spent hours scrolling through all of her content. So definitely check it out if you want your day to be a million times better. And thank you, Chloe, for letting me use some of it for this video. So, like I had said, tardigrades are little tiny microscopic animals. They have 8 legs and I guess kind of resemble bears, hence the name water bear, but they're also called moss piglets. When existing normally, moving around and stuff, they're made up of over 90% water and require at least a thin layer of water surrounding them, so they're technically considered an aquatic species, and they're found in all aquatic environments, from puddles to wet moss to the deep sea. But they've also been found in sand dunes, Antarctica, and active lava fields. So how the fuck can they do that? Well, cryptobiosis, obviously. But how? Let's take the puddle example, which will eventually dry out. So the tardigrade must undergo the form of cryptobiosis to prevent desiccation. It curls up into this tiny ball called a ton. Think of turning into a ton as pretty much shrinking into this raisin made of steel, but the steel is sugar. More than 95% of the water in their body is lost and replaced with a, how do I pronounce that?
Trehalose.
I never would have guessed that. And replaced with a protective sugar called trehalose, along with some other really important protective proteins. And once the process is done, and they are a ton, their metabolism can lower to less than 0.1% of what it was before. They are, like I said before, practically dead. And once their environment goes back to normal, the water seeps back in like a breath of fresh air, and they just go about their business. That alone is pretty crazy. It doesn't need to get any cooler than that, but it does. I've compiled a list of conditions that tardigrades have survived due to the powers of cryptobiosis, and this is not nearly a complete list. They've survived environments with no oxygen and no water, temperatures as high as 304 degrees Fahrenheit and as low as negative 328 degrees Fahrenheit. They've been chilled in liquid helium to negative 457 degrees Fahrenheit, survived boiling alcohol, levels of x-ray radiation 1,000 times the lethal human dose, pressures 6 times the pressures of the deepest parts of the ocean, and even the vacuum of outer space. And just last year, in 2021, scientists discovered they could survive being shot out of a high-speed gun. which at that point, what the fuck? Are you drunk? While their survival abilities are unheard of, it doesn't mean that they're indestructible. They're made of the same basic compounds that we are, and anything that can obliterate those compounds can obliterate a tardigrade. And most of the experiments understanding their survivability that I just listed also came, of course, with an understanding of the limits that do wipe them out. For example, the high-speed gun. They determined they could survive impact speeds of almost 3,000 feet per second, but anything beyond that, they're toast. Okay, so how long can a tardigrade survive in their ton state? It's kind of hard to pinpoint since we can't manipulate time like that yet, but they have been known to survive for years as a ton, with exceptional cases reaching beyond a decade. 100 years is often a number that gets thrown around when talking about them, but it seems to be an exaggeration. But over a decade with no food or energy input is still bananas. But the next animal I'm going to tell you about will make that amount of time seem microscopic. Rotifers. You might have never heard of them. They're unfortunately rarely talked about. They're microscopic filter-feeding animals found in freshwater habitats, and also sometimes moss like tardigrades. The name rotifer means wheelbearer and refers to their corona, a crown of cilia around their mouth that beat rapidly in a way that looks like spinning wheels sometimes. And a good chunk of species also take part in cryptobiotic capabilities. And for a long time, it was thought they could survive in that state for 6 to 10 years. Until 2021, a frozen rotifer was dug up from Siberian permafrost. Scientists allowed it to thaw out and it started moving around, eating, and asexually reproducing. How old was that permafrost, you might ask? It was radiocarbon dated to 24,000 years old. The rotifer underwent cryptobiosis during the fucking ice age, stayed frozen that way for 24,000 years, and then regained life in a lab surrounded by scientists and technology and gadgets and shit. Dude, it's like that episode of SpongeBob. Okay, so you might be thinking, how do we know it wasn't contaminated? What if a rotifer from today contaminated that piece of ground? And luckily, the scientists addressed that in the paper. They sequenced the genetic material of the entire core fragment the rotifer was found in, and by identifying and comparing different gene sequences and science that would make this video 2 hours long, they determined it was not contamination, and that the rotifer was just fucking there for 24,000 years, making it the longest verified time an animal has spent in a cryptobiotic state that we know of. I said verified because there's another animal that supposedly exceeds this record by over 15,000 years, a nematode. Nematodes, or roundworms, are an extremely diverse group of animals, some of the most abundant animals on Earth, and they're found in practically every environment possible, including the insides of humans and other animals as parasites. They range from microscopic to 28 feet long as parasites in the insides of sperm whales, and some possess the ability to do cryptobiosis. Back in 2018, a group of scientists in Siberia found nematodes in two samples of permafrost that dated to 32,000 years old and 41,000 years old. They were thawed out and then started moving around and eating. So then, are they actually the record holders of the longest time spent in cryptobiosis? A nematologist named Robin M. Giblin Davis, a nematode expert, said that this is theoretically possible, being frozen and protected from physical damage and not really using any energy to stay alive. I mean, why not? But contamination is also a huge possibility. The team did ensure sterility in their own procedures, and they listed multiple reasons why the nematodes wouldn't have been able to burrow into those depths of permafrost. But I don't know. I'll include a link to the paper if you want to read it and tell me what you think. And before I go, I want to show you some things that I made. This beanie. And a coloring book. If you don't know me from my short form content, this might be a little confusing, but this is a deep sea telescope fish, and I call him my son. And I've been making videos of him since I first started TikTok over 2 years ago. And people shit on him a lot, so I put him on a beanie to spite them all. And I also made this coloring book for my spooky specimen series that I did through October. This is the second coloring book that I've made. Where's my other one? Oh, it's right here. This is the first one I made. This is the second one. This one's new and improved. I was able to work out the kinks of the first one. It includes all the animals from the series that I did throughout October, so 31 specimens. There's one place in here, technically. And descriptions that I wrote of each one. I had so much fun making these, dude, so if you're interested, you can check it out in the link provided to snag it. And if you like this video, make sure to subscribe so you don't miss my next long form video coming up next week. And you can keep up with my daily short form content on Instagram and TikTok. And for now, stay curious. The world has a lot for us to learn. See ya!